Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 24th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. With apologies from Colette Stevenson this morning, and I welcome David Torrance, who's attending as our substitute. So welcome, David. And we move to agenda item one, which is declaration of interest. Our first item of business is for David Torrance to declare his interest. So can I invite David to declare any relevant interests?
Thank you, Convener, and I have no relevant interest to declare.
Okay, thank you. I also understand that Jeremy Balfour would like to make a comment at this point.
Thank you, Convener. Just for the avoidance of doubt, to remind members that I am in receipt of a higher rate of PIP and I'm also a former member of the Tribunal Service.
Okay, thank you, Jeremy Balfour, for putting that on the record this morning. And we now move to agenda item two, which is stage two of the Social Security Amendment Scotland Bill. So that's the first item of business. The Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Sherilyn Somerville, joins us, so thank you for coming along. You're joined today by your official, so thank you for coming along as well. But in these moments, only yourself that can speak, Cabinet Secretary. Everyone should have with them a copy of the bill as introduced, the marshalled list of amendments that was published on the 6th of September, and the grouping of amendments which sets out the amendments in the order that they will be debated. There will be one debate on each group of amendments. I will call the member who lodged the first amendment in that group to speak to and move that amendment, and to speak to all other amendments in the group. Members who have not lodged amendments in the group but who wish to speak should indicate that by catching my attention in the room today. The debate in the group will be considered by me, by inviting members, the member who moved the first amendment in the group, to wind up. Standing orders give any Scottish Minister the right to speak on any amendment. I will therefore invite the Cabinet Secretary to contribute to the debate just before I move to call the winding up speech. Following debate in each group, I will check whether the member who moved the first amendment in the group wishes to press it to a vote or to withdraw it. If they wish to press ahead, I will put the question on that amendment. If a member wishes to withdraw their amendment after it has been moved, they must seek the committee agreement to do so. If any committee member objects, the committee immediately moves to a vote on that amendment. If any member does not want to move their amendment when called, they should say not moved. Please note that any other MSP may move such an amendment. If no one moves the amendment, I will immediately call the next amendment on the marshalled list. Only committee members are allowed to vote. Voting in any decision is by a show of hands. It is important that members keep their hands clearly raised until the clerk has recorded the vote. The convener has a personal vote as a committee member and also a casting vote in the event of a tie. As the convener is not available as deputy convener, I am carrying out that function today. It is entirely a matter for my discretion how to use my casting vote. There are no agreed conventions. However, if the casting vote is used, I intend to indicate on the basis each time how I am using the casting vote immediately before I do so. The committee is required to indicate formally that it has considered and agreed each section and schedule of the bill. And so I will put a question on each section at the appropriate point. And after all that is now on the record, everyone, we'll move to the consideration of amendments. And we start off at section one and our first grouping on childhood assistance. And I call Amendment 15 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, group with amendments as shown in the groupings. Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 15 and to speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning. And I move Amendment 15 and I'll speak to it and the other amendments in this group. The Scottish Government's amendments in this group would simplify our approach to providing income-based benefits for children and young people by broadening the scope of the childhood assistance provisions at Section 1 of the Bill and by repealing the associated existing provisions on early years assistance in the 2018 Act. I'd like to be clear that the primary reason for taking the new childhood assistance powers is to allow the Scottish child payment to be put on a new legislative footing. However, the chance to provide for eligibility to be the same for all of our five family payments is one that I believe we should progress while we have the opportunity provided by this bill. These changes will give Scottish ministers more flexibility in how they develop regulations to support children from low-income families in the future, and allow for longer-term improvements to the experience of clients accessing the range of support currently offered by the five family payments. Turning now to some specific aspects of the amendments. Amendments 19 and 17 add additional primary eligibility criteria to the childhood assistance provisions, broadly mirroring the existing early years provisions in the 2018 Act, with some adjustments to the criteria in relation to the definition of pregnant women and persons with a relationship to them, and persons who are to or have become responsible for a child and persons with a relationship to them. Amendment 20 also widens the scope for giving assistance in relation to a specific event in a child's life. And Amendment 18 allows for ministers to create regulations which support families who were receiving childhood assistance and the child to whom the claim relates passed away during the course of that claim. Amendment 15 provides for the repeal of the existing early years provisions in the 2018 Act, with Amendments 80 making transitional provisions for the Best Start grants. Turning to Amendment 7 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, I believe it seeks to impose a duty on Scottish ministers to define through regulations what being responsible for a child means for the purpose of receiving assistance. It also requires them to provide assistance in relation to a child to the individual who is responsible for them at any point. Now, I absolutely share Mr Balfour's concern about making sure we are paying the money to the right person, and I'm grateful for his continued interest in this and for our recent discussion on the topic. However, his amendment is unnecessary. The regulations under the 2018 Act for our current low-income benefits for children already set out a child responsibility test and also contain a competing claims process which can be used when child responsibility is disputed. This amendment is also based on the assumption that there can be only one parent responsible for a child at any given time, which is often not the case. This approach could unintentionally undermine amicable shared care arrangements. Social Security Scotland have existing processes in place to resolve disputes between parents and act promptly on any change in circumstances, having the ability to make a change in who payments are made to if required. I have set out more information on this to Mr Balfour in recent correspondence, and I trust he's had the opportunity to consider that. As drafted, I should also note that this amendment may also affect young people aged 16 and above who wish to manage their own assistance and have the capacity to do so, as is currently possible with child disability payment. The Government therefore does not support Amendment 7, and I would ask Mr Balfour not to press it. I would urge members to support my other amendments, my amendments in this group, and they allow us to set the groundwork for improvements to the 5 family payments in the future, but to reject Amendment 7. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Jeremy Balfour to speak to Amendment 7 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Deputy Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, colleagues. If I can, first of all, just confirm that we will be supporting all the amendments in the name of the Cabinet Secretary within this particular grouping. Can I turn now to my Amendment 7, and can I again at the start thank the Cabinet Secretary for her engagement on this and also for her letter 16 September, which was helpful. I think the Cabinet Secretary has said that we, all of us, are making sure that the money follows the child and that those who are responsible for the child should get the money. I welcome the information within the letter. I think it does maybe show that this information is not broadly understood by the wider third sector, and I think it would be helpful if the Government and Social Security Scotland could maybe make this better known so that parents and third sector organisations advising parents are aware of this, because certainly the feedback that I've had from organisations is that they were not aware of this. The second question maybe that the Cabinet Secretary could deal with in her closing is that my understanding that this is guidance rather than regulation, and I suppose my only concern is that guidance can be changed by Social Security Scotland or by the Scottish Government without the Parliament knowing of that happening. And obviously we are trying to proof this bill, not just for now, but for future years and future generations. And so I do again wonder whether there could be some way that the committee and the Parliament can be kept up to date of any changes in regard to that. However, in the light of what the Cabinet Secretary has said, I won't be pressing Amendment 7 today.
Thank you very much, Mr Balfour. Do any other members wish to come in at this point? Okay, with no other member wishing to speak, I would ask the Cabinet Secretary if she wishes to wind up.
Very briefly, Convener, again, with thanks to Jeremy Balfour for our discussions on these issues, I think they have raised an important point, and as he points out, his conversations with stakeholders have suggested that this isn't an area that is understood by the third sector, and that is the agency's responsibility, not that of the third sector, to make sure that we do something about that. So I would give confirmation to Mr Balfour that I will speak to the agency and ask them to carry out further work with the third sector on wider stakeholder engagement to ensure that this guidance is understood. He asks about further reassurances that I can give about changes in guidance. I think that again is an important point, not just on this issue but on other issues, that if the agency is making significant changes to guidance, then there should be a process to alert both stakeholders and indeed committee to that. So I will take that away, reflect with the agency senior team about how best to do that, and I give my assurances that we will work to provide reassurance on that for future-proofing that process in the future.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The question, therefore, is that Amendment 15 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 16. The name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 15. Cabinet Secretary, move formally.
Moved, Convener.
The question is that Amendment 16 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendments 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22 and 23, all in the name of the Cabinet Secretary and all previously debated. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to move Amendments 17 to 23 on block.
Moved on block.
Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendment 17 through to 23?
No.
Okay. That being the case, the question is that Amendment 17 to 23 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. We move to the next group, which is relaxation of applicants' deadlines, and I call Amendment 24. In the name of the Cabinet Secretary, group with Amendments 105 and 28. Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 24 and to speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. Amendments 24 and 28 amend the 2018 Act in order to allow late applications for social security assistance. Stakeholders, including the Scottish Association for Mental Health, One Parent Family Scotland and Stirling Council, called for this change while noting that flexibility is already allowed for some benefits. Our public consultation and our work with our client and research panels showed strong support for late application in exceptional circumstances. Amendments 24 and 28 ensure a fairer system, allowing more people to access benefits, even if they sometimes miss deadlines. The committee may remember when I appeared last at Stage 1, I said that we absolutely agree that Social Security should be as accessible and accommodating as possible, and that the government considers it worthwhile, even if it helps only a handful of cases. After all, that handful of cases will involve people who are potentially exceptionally vulnerable and who may be in the most difficult of circumstances. The bill as laid repeals Section 52B of the 2018 Act, which allowed for the relaxation of deadlines where COVID was the reason for a late application for assistance. The government considered whether to make a global provision on the face of the bill, similar to Section 52B, as Paul O'Kane has suggested in his Amendment 105, replacing reasons relating to COVID with a more general good reasons or exceptional circumstances test. Section 52B, which was inserted onto the face of the 2018 Act by the Emergency Bill, delivered at the height of a global pandemic, takes an overarching approach to accepting late applications for assistance. In those unprecedented circumstances, with legal restrictions in place on everyday life, the provision was a suitable temporary solution to ensure that people were not penalised for missing application deadlines. Thankfully, time has moved on and those restrictions have been lifted. The Scottish Government delivers 14 forms of assistance, all of which have different eligibility criteria and crucially different application deadlines. Our view is that the approach in Amendments 24 and 28 is therefore the best one. Drafting is framed broadly to allow the regulations for each kind of assistance to make provision about the circumstances in which a late application is allowed. That gives it three distinct advantages over the approach in Amendment 105. First, I emphasise that it creates a very wide power to make provision and regulations about the entire circumstances for late applications very generally. It does not limit the provision to a single principle, such as allowing good reasons or exceptional circumstances for late applications, as Amendment 105 would do. Instead, this approach would allow a tailored and potentially different provision to be made for each kind of assistance, responding to the agency's practical experience on the ground of delivering that particular assistance. So as well as being more flexible, this way of doing it has the second advantage that it should result in a more beneficial and responsive approach for individuals. Thirdly, our approach also ensures that all rules relating to a form of assistance will be in the same place. A cross-cutting approach across the full range of payments would work less effectively, requiring readers of the legislation to effectively superimpose the provision on top of various sets of rules contained in the number of different sets of regulations. The application processes and deadlines are set out in regulations for each form of assistance, and it is appropriate that any relaxation to those application deadlines should also be set out in those regulations rather than on the face of the bill. For those reasons, I ask Paul O'Kane not to press his amendment, and I move 24 in my name.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Paul O'Kane to speak to Amendment 105 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you very much, Convener. This amendment 105 introduces the ability for assistance to be backdated where applicable. The power allows Social Security Scotland to award entitlement in a range of circumstances that were not foreseen within the 2018 Act and the subsequent regulations that were drafted. And I am pleased that the amendment has the support of the Child Poverty Action Group in Scotland, and evidence from CPAG in Scotland's early warning system highlights that individuals can lose out on money which they were entitled to if they applied earlier, because entitlement cannot be backdated to a date before an application was received. And I believe members will have received examples from CPAG of where this is relevant in the Stage 2 briefing that they produced. And of course, I will just refer to some of those scenarios, if I may. Delayed applications in terms of entitlement to Scottish Child Payment being dependent on an individual receiving a qualifying benefit. Applications that span reaching adult or pension age, terminal illness and issues therein, and change of circumstances between application, submission and decision for adult disability payment. So this amendment really seeks to speak to the principles behind the social security system, and that is there to provide a safety net to the most vulnerable when they need it, and the system should not have people losing out without good reason, and particularly where it was that the system responsible for the delay in accessing assistance hadn't been taken into account. I recognise what the Cabinet Secretary has said in her remarks, and would recognise that there can be practical implications, indeed financial and otherwise, for Government and Social Security Scotland to consider in terms of the implementation of backdating. I think it's important, however, that we ensure that the principle of backdating is at the centre of the system, and that this amendment can seek to do that for the situations which I have referenced in my remarks. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Mr O'Kane. Mr Balfour?
Thank you, Deputy Convener. I mean, I think this is important. Amendments, all three of them are important, and I think it's a really helpful debate. And also, I think it shows what this bill can do. It goes back and review what we did initially, how it's worked in practice and how it can be improved. On balance, I think probably on this occasion, the Scottish Government have probably got the amendments more correct than the one of Mr Kane, although in fact they are seeking to do almost exactly the same thing. But I think for the reasons given by the Cabinet Secretary, we will be supporting Amendment 24 and 28, and with reluctance not supporting Mr Kane's amendment.
Thank you, Mr Balfour. Any other member wish to speak at this point? Okay, Cabinet Secretary, would you like to wind up?
Thank you, Convener. Again, very briefly, I would agree with Mr Balfour's point that we have a broad agreement today about the policy intent, and there is, a very important aspect around ensuring that what was designed in 2018 is fit for purpose, and what we have learned during that period. I would thank CPAG for their work on this amendment and for Paul O'Kane for bringing his amendment forward, because it does demonstrate that there are different ways of doing the same policy intent. For the reasons that I've pointed out, I do think the government's approach is better. Mr O'Kane's remarks point to the very wide ranges of circumstances that we're trying to encapsulate. And for that very reason, I think it's important that we do that through the regulations themselves, to ensure that they're fit for purpose for each type of benefit and payment. So for those reasons, convener, I would still request that Mr O'Kane doesn't move his amendment. Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. So the question is that Amendment 24 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We move to a new group on assistance given in error, and I call Amendment 25 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Group with amendments as shown in the groupings. Cabinet Secretary, move Amendment 25 and to speak to all amendments within the group.
Thank you very much, convener. This group contains 26 Scottish Government amendments in total, all in relation to liability for assistance paid in error. We heard concerns from stakeholders and from members during stage one that the provisions in the bill as laid, whilst welcome in principle, were quite confusing. I have listened to those concerns, and we have accordingly redrafted the provisions around overpayment liability in their entirety to more clearly set out our approach to overpayment liability. First, before I turn to the substantive change, Amendments 25, 26 and 51 in my name close a gap in the 2018 Act in relation to assistance paid in error. As the committee is aware, liability for overpayments arises from Section 63 of the 2018 Act, or, in the case of the Scottish Child Payment, the corresponding regulations made under Section 79. At the current time, the provisions for deductions in the schedules for assistance paid under Chapter 2 of the 2018 Act only allow the Scottish ministers to make a deduction in respect of overpayment of assistance paid under the 2018 Act, whereas the Scottish Child Payment regulations provide for deduction for overpayments of assistance either under the 2018 Act or under the Scottish Child Payment regulations. What this means in practice is that an overpayment of Scottish Child Payment or any other form of assistance that is created using top-up powers in the future cannot be repaid by deduction from any other ongoing benefit. So if a person has an overpayment in their adult disability payment, this can be repaid by deduction from the Scottish Child Payment, but not the other way around. Deductions are often a preferred and simple method for someone to repay an overpayment, as they are set at a manageable level. As I'm sure the committee is aware, deductions may only be made at a level which is reasonable, taking into account individuals' financial circumstances and in order to prevent hardship, and they have challenge rights. Amendment 51 therefore closes a gap and ensures that individuals have the convenience of knowing deductions for overpayments from any form of ongoing assistance can be recovered from another in accordance with our long-standing policy position. It does this by inserting a new provision into the deduction provisions within schedules of the 2018 Act to include any liabilities arising from any top-up assistance regulations. Amendments 25 and 26 also future-proof the 2018 Act by mirroring the deduction provisions in the new schedule for childhood assistance and, if approved, will ensure that recovery of overpayments of Scottish Child Payment or any future top-up payment is in line with all other forms of devolved assistance. The Scottish Government's proposed amendments 29 through 34 have one overarching purpose: to provide greater clarity in relation to the liability for any assistance paid in error for individuals and for representatives who act on their behalf. When the bill was introduced, there were distinct separate sections for the liability of individuals and for the liability of their representatives. As I noted at stage one of the bill, it became clear that some stakeholders were confused about what was being proposed, and we have reflected on what we can do to make things easier and clearer. The amended text within the new sections 63, 63A and 63B deals with the liability of both individuals and their representatives, simplifying and clarifying the provisions. Despite the large number of amendments, I'd like to reassure the committee that the two key principles at introduction remain unchanged: that an individual's representative will be liable for overpaid assistance where, and only where, that representative has benefited from the overpayment, and that liability for both individuals and representatives arises from a decision of the Scottish ministers rather than automatically, allowing us to create a system of reviews and appeals rather than people having to challenge this liability in the Sheriff Court. As amended, Section 63 sets out the circumstances in which Scottish ministers can decide where an individual or their representative is liable for an overpayment. Some stakeholders were concerned that the provisions did not make clear enough how liability would be decided between an individual and their representative, so we've clarified that. The new provisions retain key concepts from the 2018 Act, such as definitions of error, fault, and what should be considered when deciding if an error is the sort of error a person could have reasonably been expected to notice. So again, and I want to be crystal clear on this point, the protections of the 2018 Act do remain in place. The new section frames the questions around liability in a more straightforward manner, but the underlying concepts, the policy intent and implementation remain the same. Whereas previously the 2018 Act contained exclusions from liability, the provisions have been simplified and now focus on establishing when someone is liable for an overpayment rather than when they are not. I trust the committee agrees this is a clearer way to set out how liability applies. Amendments 30, 31 and 32 remove the sections of the bill that have been replaced by the new text in sections 63, 63A and 63B. Amendments 33 and 34 relate to section 69 of the 2018 Act, which focuses upon the liability for assistance given for a period after death. Sections 12.2 and 12.3 of the bill as introduced amended section 69 of the 2018 Act. They renamed and modified it to specify that if a person on liability was if a decision on liability was made after a person had died, their estate would become liable to repay the sums that the person would have been liable for had they not died. Following stage one of the bill, we have reflected upon this and have instead made provision for this in subsections 10 and 11 of the modified section 63 in amendment 29. This makes it clearer that the original drafting by covering all liability decisions in the same place. Amendments 33 and 34 therefore delete the changes proposed to section 69 by the bill at introduction. Amendment 33 also allows Scottish ministers to recover any assistance paid in the period after an eligible person has died, whether this is a result of a determination or as some other error, such as a systems error. The remaining amendments in the group, numbered 35 through 50, are minor technical amendments to make consequential changes to the bill to ensure that the section numbers and references to individuals or their representatives are consistent with the newly inserted provisions. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I call Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Convener. I'd just like to note that we've nearly got half an hour with consensus, although that may now not be quite the case we are. I welcome what the Government has brought forward, but I do think it still leaves a bit of concern around third-party representation. It is often very hard to find somebody who will represent you. Much representation is done on a voluntary basis, and I still am concerned that as drafted at the moment, this provision will put people off giving assistance. CPAC, when we gave evidence to the committee, said we would not want to discourage people from being representatives. Now, I appreciate the government has amended what was there before, but I still don't think it goes far enough. Glasgow City Council and CPAC also pointed out that it might be difficult in practice to disentangle how much liability rests with the individual and how much with the representative. And again, I think although there had been movement in regard to that, that issue still arises. When does the person who is representing benefit and when does the person making the claim get that? So Matt, as it is, I am unable to support Amendment 29. I would ask the government to think about it again and to give greater protection to third-party representation, or I fear that we will see people who volunteer their time not willing to do that. For that reason, although Amendment 30 is not perfect, we will be voting to leave it in to allow the government to come back and reflect again on that. I also have some concerns in regard to Amendment 33, and that is when they go after someone's estate. Again, perhaps it's my lack of understanding, but I would be interested to know how long did that period last that a claim could be made against an estate, because we could end up with families wanting to distribute assets to other family members, but not able to do that because it's held up in some kind of claim being made by Social Security Scotland. So I think if we're going to have that in, would the government reflect on having some kind of timescale in regard to that, and what protection would be given to residue benefits? Could the Cabinet Secretary also just clarify that representatives will have a right to review as individuals have? Because obviously in Section 39, that right of review has been taken away, but I think it is in regard to number 29, but it would be get that on the record. I think all of us have the same intent, that we want people to be represented where we feel that they would be best for them. That is often done by a third party. That third party in practice is often a volunteer, and I am concerned that as still drafted, people will be put off by this. And I think it's an opportunity for us still to reflect and see if we can give greater protection to third parties. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Balfour. Any other member wish to speak at this point? Okay. Cabinet Secretary, would you like to wind up?
Thank you, Convener. Mr. Balfour is quite right to say that third-party representation is exceptionally important for people. Again, there is no disagreement between him and I on the intent that we're trying to get at here. And I thank you very much for bringing this again to committee and to my attention. I absolutely recognise the concern if it's still out there, and I'm more than happy to carry on discussions with Mr. Balfour and indeed with stakeholders directly to see if there's more that can be done to reassure in between stages 2 and 3. I'm not entirely sure whether it requires an amendment at this stage, so you'll forgive me, Mr. Balfour, if I don't put that reassurance to you to date, but I very much will undertake, say, to have direct consultation with stakeholders and with Mr. Balfour to see if more can be done, because we do not want to do anything that puts people off. Volunteers are an exceptionally important part of this process, and I absolutely understand where he is coming from on that. My understanding is that any claim on the estate would be part of the usual executory practice, so those deadlines and timeframes are set out in regulation out with Social Security, but there would be no delay because of what is in Social Security. So hopefully that gives Mr. Balfour reassurance on that. And yes, there would be a right to review as well. So I hope he is reassured by that. So on those points, Convener, I hope I've been able to provide some reassurance. As I said in my opening remarks, many of these amendments are technical in nature, but Mr. Balfour has raised a particular point around third party representation, which I'm very happy to further consider with him and indeed others, should they so wish.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The question is that Amendment 25 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. I call Amendment 26 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 25. Cabinet Secretary, formally move.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 26 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The question is that Section 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
And we move to Section 2 and a new group, Care Experience Assistance. I call Amendment 1 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, group with Amendments 27 and 2. Jeremy Balfour to move Amendment 1 to speak to other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Deputy Convener. This area introduces a new benefit called Care Experience Assistance. I have to say, beyond that, we have no idea what we are voting for today. There is no substantial detail in regard to how this will work, what is a carer experience, who will benefit from it, what are the timescales involved and what process will take place? And it does seem to me slightly strange that we are voting for a new benefit without any of that detail. Now, we all want care experience assistance. Some of us attended an event yesterday afternoon where we heard about some of the negative experiences those in care have. But I find it difficult to just leave it an open-ended cheque to the government to go away with and do whatever they want. Now, clearly regulations will come at some point, but with due respect to the Cabinet Secretary, timescales within this government do seem to slip from time to time. What I am seeking to do is to make sure that this benefit actually comes about in a timely manner. And so what my amendments seek to do is to say that these regulations have to be laid within 24 months of royal assent of the bill. I think that gives plenty of time for the government to do its stakeholder engagement. I think it gives plenty of time for this committee and for Parliament to scrutinise those regulations and make sure that they are appropriate. And it means that we're not leaving those who are expecting this assistance not knowing when or if this will come forward. Again, none of us know what's going to happen in 14 or 15 months' time with an election. A different government could be elected who have completely different priorities, and this care experience assistance would simply disappear off the map and never happen. So I think all of us, again, have the same policy intent as the Cabinet Secretary. What this simply seeks to do is to make the government move maybe slightly quicker than we have in the past, and to give both stakeholders and this committee reassurance that it will actually happen. Thank you, Deputy Commissioner.
Thank you, Mr Balfour. Cabinet Secretary, speak to Amendment 27 and other amendments within the group.
Thank you, Convener. Firstly, as we've heard, these amendments all relate to care experience assistance. The bill, as introduced, does take a broad regulation-making power to create one or more schemes to provide financial assistance to people with care experience. Whilst the intention is to use the regulation-making power to create the care leaver payment in the first instance, other forms of assistance may be delivered under the provision in the future. Amendment 1 by Jeremy Balfour seeks to place a statutory duty on Scottish ministers to create one or more schemes to provide financial assistance to people with care experience. And Amendment 2 seeks to ensure the regulations are laid within 2 years of the bill receiving royal assent. While I appreciate the intention behind Mr Balfour's amendments, I would like to reassure the committee that the Scottish Government remains committed to the care leaver payment and resolute in our commitment to keep the promise by 2030. Officials continue to progress focused work on the care leaver payment, including a public consultation and dedicated engagement sessions, and an independent analysis report on that work was published on the 18th of June. This report is vital in ensuring that the voices of people with care experience are at the heart of the policy developed on the payment. Whilst work is progressing at pace on the development of the care leaver payment, timelines for the delivery of the payment are dependent on the timescales of the bill and subsequent legislative processes, including the laying of regulations. But I can hopefully reassure Mr Balfour and the committee that the intention is very much to proceed so that this is complete within the end of this parliament, before the end of this parliamentary session. The current provisions in the bill include a requirement to consult ahead of care experience assistance regulations being laid. This provides a further opportunity to engage with those who have care experience and the wider public to ensure that the care leaver payment best meets the needs of young people before it is delivered. Regulations will be laid to deliver the care leaver payment once the results of that future consultation have been analysed and fully considered. The proposed wording for Amendment 1 would also create an inconsistency between care experience assistance and the regulation-making powers in respect of other assistance given under the 2018 Act. There is no precedence elsewhere in that Act. On Amendment 2, as I have mentioned, the new power in the bill could be used in future to deliver other forms of assistance for care experienced people, as well as the care leaver payment. The time restriction on the laying of regulations proposed in Amendment 2 would cut across that and restrict our ability to offer support to those who need it in the future. I am sure members would not want to do that. I think we would want to preserve the flexibility of the bill as introduced. So on that basis, the Government does not support Amendments 1 and 2, and I would ask Jeremy Balfour not to press them. Amendment 27 in my name adds the power to make provision for redeterminations, which mirrors the languages and processes currently used by Social Security Scotland and contained in the 2018 Act. The inclusion of redeterminations in the provision future-proofs the regulating-making power should Social Security Scotland be the preferred delivery vehicle for any schemes created under care experienced assistance. I conclude my remarks on this group by asking the committee to support Amendment 27 and urge the committee to reject Mr Balfour's amendment.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Any other member like to come in? Paul Keane.
Very much, Convener. Perhaps just briefly on this set of amendments, and I think in similar to all the contributions so far, there is a desire to make sure that care leavers are well supported and that these payments do come on stream at the right time. I think what is key here, and I do have a degree of sympathy with Jeremy Balfour's Amendment 1 in terms of ensuring that the Government do bring forward regulations in that regard. I think very often we've seen things not happen, and I think having timescales is important. But what I would caveat that in saying is it's important that this is designed by people who are care experienced and who sit within the very well-established structures that I think there are across work on the promise and on other issues. And I think in terms of taking evidence in the initial stage of the bill, that was something that we spoke about in committee. So I do have a degree of sympathy in terms of trying to set out and compel ministers to do that. In terms of Amendment 2, I mean, I would put to Jeremy Balfour that his concern about the timing of the election and the implementation of regulations that could have a negative impact depending on the outcome of that election and who forms that government. It could go the other way, of course, and you could look at it as someone might want to change the regulations to be more wide-ranging or to do something different depending on further consultation and different groupings. So I do think that works both ways, so I have less perhaps sympathy in terms of that amendment. And on Amendment 27 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, we're obviously happy to support that in terms of the tidying up and technical nature of it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr O'Keane. Any other contributions from members? Okay, there have been none. Can I ask Jeremy Balfour to wind up and to press or withdraw Amendment 1?
Thank you, Vigini. Just to clarify, we do support Amendment 27 in the Cabinet Secretary's name as well. I think perhaps when you just become old and cynical like me, you do hear these words. And having been on this committee now for, I think, 7 years, if I had a pound for every time that the intention is to do this, I would be in the Bahamas, be very happily in the Bahamas by myself. And so I am concerned that this could slip. You know, none of us knows what's around the corner. Other priorities can come forward for Scottish Government. It was interesting, some of us attended yesterday afternoon a meeting with the Board of the Promise, and I think they are quite critical in regard to the progress that is being made and the slowness around that. And I think their view is that they want to see something happen. Now, I absolutely agree with Mr O'Kane that it is important that this is designed with the appropriate stakeholders in mind. I think we can do that in a 2-year period. If future governments come and want to make alterations, then they can do that. But I still am concerned that the track record for this Parliament about delivering the promises that we make are not great. And so it is my intention to move Amendment 1, Deputy Convener, and put this timescale onto the government on the hope that we can all get to where we want to, but within a reasonable time. So I move Amendment 1 in my name.
Okay, thank you, Mr Balfour. That being the case, the question is that Amendment 1 be agreed. Are we all agreed? Okay, we are not agreed. So we'll now move to a vote. Can I ask all those in favour of Amendment 1 to raise your hand, please? That's 4. All those against Amendment 1? That's 4. There will be no abstentions to be recorded. So that is a tied vote. In such circumstances, as convener, I have my discretion to use my casting vote. I would intend to use that the same way as I use my personal vote, and I will be voting against the amendment. So Amendment 1 falls.
I call Amendment 27 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 1. Cabinet Secretary, move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 27 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 2 in the name of Jeremy Balfour. Already debated with Amendment 1. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not to move?
Not move, Convener.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Balfour. The question is that Amendment 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No, he didn't move it, so therefore the question is that section two.
So I would like to thank members for stepping into the deliberate trap I set for you. That being the case, consider yourself suitably chastised. And the question is that section two rather be agreed to. Yes. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Okay, we now move to a new grouping, carer support payment. I call Amendment 3 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, grouped with Amendment 4. Jeremy Balfour, to move Amendment 3 and to speak to both amendments in the group.
Thank you, Deputy Convener. The next few sections are all in regard to increasing the amount of money that Scottish Government pays to the most vulnerable in society. We all, as we know, are in a difficult financial situation, and that is likely to continue for the foreseeable future. However, in regard to that, I don't think that means we stop looking after the most vulnerable in our society. As the Deputy Convener likes to say on numerous occasions at this committee, we all have political choices to make. And this is political choices that we now have to make as a committee and ultimately as a parliament. We all recognise that carers in our society do an immense amount of work. Work which goes unseen and which saves the taxpayer billions of pounds a year. For those that care for loved ones, whether that is a husband or a wife, a child or another relative, the sacrifices those carers make is immense. Many of them have to change their jobs or give up their jobs. Many of them have to rechange their social life. And they also see, sadly, towards the end of that individual's life, often the pain that they are going through and the lack of fulfilment within their life. Many carers make that sacrifice because they love the person that they're caring for. But that comes at a cost. I'm pleased that the government has moved to some extent in regard to this, in extending the carer support payment post-death. However, I think we can go further in regard to that. And what my amendment number 3 seeks to do, Deputy Convener, is to extend that payment for 6 months. 6 months where the person who has given so much can readjust to a whole new life. Readjust emotionally and physically, but also readjust their financial situation in regard to what they want to do next. Many will perhaps have to seek training or upskilling their skills to get a job. Others will have to do CVs and go for job interviews. Others will simply need the time and space to grieve the loss of someone they have poured so much into. I don't think it's unreasonable for us as a society to acknowledge that and to extend it to 6 months. Having spoken to many carers' organisations, they say the one big change that they would look to make is this extension to 6 months. Yes, I appreciate that the Cabinet Secretary will rightly say it will come as a cost, but think of the cost that those people have given for the rest of us in society. In regard to my Amendment 4, this is an issue that has come up again and again in regard to the hard cliff edge, that if you simply step over the line, you lose everything. That is true for the carer support payment, it's true for other payments as well. Now, I am not suggesting that this is an easy issue for us to deal with, and I know greater minds than I have tried to look at it. But I do think with the right wind and the right engagement with the sector, with government, with lawyers, we can identify a tapering system, which means that if somebody's financial situation changes just slightly, they would get less payment but not lose all their payments. I think that can be done through regulation, and I think it can be done fairly quickly. So what I would like to see is the government commit to looking at this tapering process, which gives the protection of individuals who are caring for someone a bit of flexibility not to lose the whole benefit just by some small change in circumstances. I believe these two amendments together would readdress where carers are at the moment. It would not address all the issues, but I think it would be a massive step forward. And I think as we as a Parliament were to accept these amendments, the message that would come would be very positive to the many hundreds of people who care for people across Scotland. Thank you, Deputy Convener.
OK. Mr Balfour, clerks have advised that it would be helpful if you could move the Amendment 3 at this point.
I am happy to move Amendment 3 formally.
OK. Are there any other members wishing to speak at this point? So, before I bring the Cabinet Secretary in, I'll maybe make a very brief contribution that maybe the Cabinet Secretary could reflect in her reply. Understand there's already plans for the Scottish Government to extend the roll-on of this benefit. Does this require details on the face of a bill? Is this a policy decision with a budget implication that can be taken at a later date? I'm just wondering about the requirement, irrespective of how long we wish this support payment to run on for, whether it requires an amendment to be placed on the face of the legislation or not, is just the query that I have. So I've put that on the record now. Can I bring the Cabinet Secretary in at this point?
Thank you, Convener. I thank Mr Balfour for bringing forward his amendments and for his and indeed other members' continued support for carers right across this country. Mr Balfour is quite right to state once again for the record the important role that carers play. In saying that, however, Convener, the Government cannot support Amendments 3 and 4 from Mr Balfour. The Scottish Government is transforming financial support for unpaid carers in Scotland, recognising the value of unpaid care and providing greater stability and support. Carer support payment, available in 13 local authority areas and launching nationally from November, is already extending support to more carers, providing an improved service, with further key changes planned. And of course, the committee will be well aware that one of the first actions when we took up the devolution of social security powers was additional payments to carers. Mr Doris is quite right to point out to the fact that the Government is already committed to extending support for carers after the loss of a cared for person from 8 to 12 weeks. My officials are already working to deliver this, including engaging with the Department for Work and Pensions to ensure the necessary arrangements can be made to protect carers' wider support. To make sure carers already getting carers' allowance are not disadvantaged, we will make this change once the process of case transfer is complete. Amendment 3 seeks to extend this run-on to 24 weeks. This is something which we would be best to look at, I would suggest, in the future, once we have delivered the extension to 12 weeks to allow more detailed consideration of implications for budgets. As I'm sure Mr Balfour would agree, any change to entitlement that would result in increased costs for the Scottish Government that are not covered through the block grant adjustment need to be carefully considered. Indeed, many of his colleagues remind me of this responsibility in the Chamber and point out to the fact that the Scottish Government already invests £1.1 billion over block grant adjustment through Social Security. They do so, Convener, raising that as a concern, not as something which the Government should be proud of. I indeed, however, am. Further consideration and discussions with the DWP would also be needed around any extension to 24 weeks. And that's very important, as we've discussed before in the committee, because we do not want to adversely affect any other support carers rely on. We know that many carers receive extra support and other benefits, such as universal credit, because of their entitlement to carer support payment. in the same way as carers getting carers' allowance do. The more that carers' support payment diverges from carers' allowance, the greater the risk is to carers' continued eligibility for this extra support. And I would urge members, therefore, not to pass anything into legislation which would put other payments in jeopardy, no matter how good the intent is behind those amendments. Convener, I will now turn to Amendment 4, which seeks to amend provisions in the 2018 Act so carers' assistance regulations can provide for assistance to be tapered when carers' earnings increase. We recognise the concerns raised by carers and support organisations about the impact earnings rules can have on carers' ability to take on paid work. We have made improvements to earnings processes and carer support payment, working with carers and support organisations to provide clearer information for clients and calculating carers' average earnings to help provide more stable support where earnings vary. We also took feedback through our public consultation on changes we could make in the future once case transfer for carers' allowance is complete. An earnings taper, where carer support payment is gradually reduced as earnings increase, which I understand is the aim behind Amendment 4, would be one approach to changing the earnings rules. This was considered ahead of the consultation as part of a multi-criteria appraisal process undertaken with stakeholders. It found a taper would add significant complexity to the benefit in terms of build, operational delivery, clients' understanding of eligibility, and how it would interact with wider support such as universal credit. Because carer support payment affects the amounts carers receive in universal credit, and universal credit itself has an earnings taper, this would add significant complexity, in addition to the fact that the divergence from carers' allowance could again put at risk the extra support, the carer element, currently available in universal credit for those getting support, carer support payment. We explored other, potentially more effective ways to improve the earnings rules in our consultation, such as a run-on of support where carers earn over the threshold and increasing the threshold overall. We are continuing to consider the responses to this consultation, as well as further considering the potential impact on carers' wider support and affordability and sustainability in terms of the wider Scottish budget. Finally, I would highlight that even if a decision were taken in future to introduce an earnings taper for carers' assistance, that is already possible using the existing enabling powers in the 2018 Act. The proposed amendment is therefore unnecessary. For all those reasons, convener, I would urge the committee to reject Amendments 3 and 4 should Mr Balfour choose to press them.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Would you say, Jeremy Balfour, could you wind up, please, and press or withdraw Amendment 3?
Thank you, Deputy Convener. I mean, I think there have been quite a number of issues raised by the Cabinet Secretary in regard to this. I suppose at a very kind of high-level philosophical view, there is an issue here which I think the Cabinet Secretary will come back to and others will come back to time and time again about the divergence if we do things differently here in Scotland to the rest of the UK and how would DWP respond to that. I suppose at some point we are going to have to see how that challenge actually works in practice. I can see no point in having a devolved social security system that then simply all the way through mirrors what happens in DWP. That just seems to me an administrative cost that we are carrying here in Scotland. Now, I do accept that because of Social Security Scotland, we can introduce new benefits, which we'll come on to in a moment. But if we are not going to, at some point, change our view for what happens from DWP, then I think the view of my view would be, why do we have Social Security Scotland here as it is set up at the moment? So I think at some point, this government or a future government is going to have to see how DWP react to that. Absolutely.
I absolutely see where he's coming from on that. Could I suggest, though, the way to test out what the DWP will do is not by putting it in primary legislation, which is then exceptionally difficult to unpick, because we don't want to find out what the DWP will do when it's going to adversely affect clients, when the way of undoing that is exceptionally challenging. So I see the point where he's coming from, but I would strongly urge him not to use primary legislation to attempt to force the DWP's hand in such a way or to find out what they think.
I accept that, Cabinet Secretary. However, we are at stage two. If this amendment was passed today, I'm sure she could pick up a telephone or send an email down to the new cabinet secretary down south to find out how they would react to that. And at stage three, we could come back and have that debate again. Because I think one of the challenges that Mr. Dorris has picked up is that I think he is indicating, and the Cabinet Secretary is indicating, that this should be done by regulation rather than by primary legislation. The trouble is, as the Deputy Convener will know, is that you cannot vote against one bit of regulations. You either have to accept it all or reject it all. So something may come forward in regard to what the government are doing, of which 99% I think is right, but the 1% actually is the financial key thing. I wouldn't want to vote against somebody getting something without amending it. And that is why primary legislation is a better way for doing this. I again accept the Cabinet Secretary's comments about budget, but it's political choices. She makes that point often to me in the chamber, that we have political choices. I think the money that the Scottish Government has would be much better spent on supporting carers than it would be on some of the other projects that we seem to be pushing forward at the moment. And so for that reason, I will be moving Amendment 3 in my name. In regard to Amendment 4, I do accept what the Cabinet Secretary has said. I would like to go away and reflect in regard to what she has said on that. And for that reason, I won't be moving Amendment 4 today, but will reserve the right to see what happens at Stage 3.
That's fine. Mr Balfour, you already have moved Amendment 3. The question is whether you're pressing it or you're withdrawing it.
I am pressing hard, Convener.
Okay. That's certainly on the record, Mr Balfour. The question is that Amendment 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
Okay, they're not being agreed. Those in support of Amendment 3, could you raise your hands, please? Those against? My apologies. Let me just say out loud that there was four. We'll just go back and raise your hand so we do it in the correct sequence. My apologies. Those for Amendment 3, that's 4. Those against Amendment 3, that is 4. We again have a tie. As convener, I have a personal vote and a casting vote as convener. I will again use my casting vote the same way I used my personal vote. So I would vote against the amendment and the amendment falls. Call Amendment 4 in the name of Jeremy Balfour. Already debated with Amendment 3. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not move?
Not move, Convener.
Not moved. We move on to a new group on winter heating assistance. Can I indicate at this point at the end of this group we'll stop for a short comfort break, just to give members that information in advance. And I call Amendment 5 in the name of Jeremy Balfour and a group of its own. Jeremy Balfour, to move and speak to Amendment 5.
Thank you, Deputy Convener. As I spent the summer looking at amendments, possibly this was one that came forward as I was drafting. It happened before the announcement by the UK Government and the announcement by the Scottish Government in regard to winter heating payments. I think it's a very disappointing decision that the UK Government have made, affecting many individuals. And I think, and I understand why the Scottish Government done it, but again, I think it's a disappointment announcement. What Amendment 5 seeks to do is not to give all older people any kind of winter heating payment, but in regard to a specific vulnerable group within our society. We all know that many older people spend a lot longer at home compared to other people. We often understand that they live in houses that don't have the best heating or installation, but aren't able to move for many different reasons. What Amendment 5 says is that those who are on attendance allowance or on the new Scottish benefit of that, so who are over 65 and on that high rate, should receive this winter heating payment. We already do this for children under 16 who are on the high rate of care, because we recognise as a Parliament and the Government recognised that those children often are at home and that the heating costs are higher. This seems to me a reasonable mitigation of where we are at the moment, that it will give those who are at home the most the protection of some financial help in regard to meeting the winter heating payments. We all understand that next month heating prices are likely to go up across the UK. We recognise that many here in Scotland have colder conditions than the other people in the United Kingdom. And I think it's a political choice to say that we want to look after and protect some of the most vulnerable in our society seems to me the right way forward. I think we were right when we created legislation that we allowed the government, the parliament ultimately, to create new benefits. And I think this is a benefit, a new benefit, which would help, again, people who are at home, who are often cold. It's not often that I agree with Richard Leonard, but at the CPG on older people last week, he pointed out that he was concerned that we are going back to the 1970s and 80s, where we will see people dying in their homes because they are cold. We need to mitigate that as much as we can. And the people who are most likely to be affected are people with disability who cannot move around as much as others. So I think this is not something that is a wish list, that is something that is just something we could do. I think this is something we need to do to protect the most vulnerable in our society. And so I do move Amendment 5 in my name, Deputy Convener.
OK, thank you. Would other members like to come in? Paul O'Kane.
Thank you very much, Convener. And I would note what Mr Balfour has said in his contribution, and I think note more widely that pension age winter heating allowance is a newly devolved benefit to the Parliament, and it is something that we have not discussed just in recent months, but have discussed over a period in the lead-up to the devolution of that benefit. And I think we also have to acknowledge the context, as Mr Balfour referred to, in terms of the decision to extend that benefit only to those in receipt of pension credit, and the Scottish Government agreeing in terms of that rule, if you like. I think I have said, to be fair, that it is for this Parliament and indeed for this committee to continue to do work on this new benefit, and I think it's fair that it should be this Parliament and this committee who help to decide what any new benefit in Scotland looks like. And of course, I think it is discussion that will be had and should be had, and I think that that is appropriate. And I think everyone across the Parliament is willing to come together and to have that debate and that discussion in terms of criteria. I do think, though, we have to be cognisant of the fact that we have not yet had regulations. Obviously, the government have intimated that it is their intention to pass the benefit back for a temporary period of a year in order to deliver it to those in receipt of pension credit. And we have not had regulations on that yet. We have not had that debate and that discussion. And also, I have not been able yet to scrutinise and understand Social Security Scotland's system in terms of why it can't deliver a different system and why that has had to happen. So I think we have to take cognizance of where we are on that. I think also it's fair to say that there are a number of issues that need to be considered in this space about how best it might be delivered and what changes there might be. Mr Balfour has brought two enabling benefits in this space. Of course, there is more work, I think, to be done more widely on how, for example, pension credit and housing benefit interact, on what decisions and what outcomes there are of any future fiscal events at a UK level as well. So I think this is all to say that I understand why Mr Balfour has brought the amendment. I think it is important that we as a committee and as a parliament consider the benefit in a Scottish context. But I do think there are unanswered questions in terms of the proposal he has brought, not least in terms of who it would reach, cost, how that would be applied, and whether the system can deliver the benefit that he seeks. And given that we do have that year before the benefit becomes enacted and carried by Social Security Scotland, I do think it would be wise for us to consider that in the round. So whilst I don't reject this principle out of hand, I do think it is important that we have further scrutiny and further debate. And I think stage 3 also could be an appropriate place to continue that. Thank you, Convener.
Katie Clark, followed by Kevin Short.
Thank you, and I very much welcome the fact that we're having this discussion today, although, as Paul O'Kane has said, it's part of a far wider discussion that I suspect we'll be having over the coming weeks, and I have a number of questions I'd like to ask. I have already had a discussion with Jeremy Balfour and indicated that I would hope that I'd be able to work with him on a cross-party basis on this issue, and I'm sure other colleagues would want to do that as well, and I know that Scottish Labour very much want to work with the Scottish Government on this issue. It would be helpful to know if we have any information on the cost of the specific proposal before us today in relation to these specific benefits, the highest rate of attendance allowance and the highest rate of pension age disability allowance. I appreciate Mr Balfour may have that information, but it's more likely that the Scottish Government might be able to provide that information either today or indeed before stage three. But it would also be helpful to know what the cost would be if the amendment were to be expanded to include other benefits, because Mr Balfour has restricted this particular amendment to the highest rate of attendance allowance and pension age disability allowance. And I hear very clearly what he's saying, that this was drafted before the decision of the UK Parliament. But there clearly is an interrelationship with winter fuel payment and this potential new allowance. I think from what Mr Balfour is saying, that his intention would have been that this would have been in addition to winter fuel payment, which perhaps addresses one of the questions I was going to ask in relation to those who will still receive winter fuel payment because they receive pension credit. So I think he's envisaging that this would be an additional payment to winter fuel payment. So I think I'm clear on that. But what would be helpful to know would be if any costings work has been done or could be done in relation to other rates of attendance allowance, pension, age, disability allowance, housing benefit, or indeed whether any other timescales are being envisaged, and from the Scottish Government some indication of timescales as to when realistically this benefit might be implemented, given we know there often seem to be considerable administration issues, and whether that's something that the Cabinet Secretary would be able to provide today. It also would be helpful, and I suspect before stage three we might have more information on consequentials, and that obviously something that would be useful to know. I know the First Minister made a statement this week that mentioned a figure, but there will be further consequentials. I mean, a number of councils in England are considering similar steps to this, and I do think, as I say, that this is something that this Parliament will want to look at on a cross-party basis, and I very much hope that as this debate continues, that a similar amendment, or maybe one that includes other benefits, could come forward at stage three.
Kevin Short.
Thank you very much, Convener, and I recognise, first of all, that this amendment was lodged before the UK Government's decision to slash winter fuel payments. However, in itself, that is an extension to the social security system, which is something that I am not against. But Mr Balfour talked in his speech around about mitigation. Again, I'm not against mitigation, and we have mitigated a lot of cuts here in this Parliament previously. But what does annoy me, Convener, is when advocates for the union, like Mr Balfour, come here with the expectation that the Scottish Government should be able to extend, expand and mitigate when the resources are not there from the UK Treasury. And let's face facts. We are in a situation whereby the Cabinet Secretary is going to have to deal with some of these issues, knowing fine that £160 million that she expected has now been pulled by the UK Treasury. Now, I get the points that Mr O'Kane and Ms Clark have made around about further exploration of all of this, and I think that needs to be done. But also, we need to be blunt with the UK Treasury around about the scenario that we now face. Ms Clark talked about consequentials, and I am someone who always believes that, you know, we should interrogate those consequentials to see what can be done with them. But in this case, what we're facing is basically negative consequentials, with £160 million being pulled out of the Scottish Government budget at the snap of the fingers, and that's not good enough. And I think that committee members, instead of talking about expansion at this moment, have to look at the cards that we have been dealt by the UK Treasury, by the Westminster Government, and have to recognise that we cannot mitigate every single thing, particularly when £160 million has disappeared like that.
Thank you very much, Mr Stewart. Just before I bring the Cabinet Secretary in, I'd like to make a very brief contribution, which I'll not make in a political vein. I clearly got some very strong views in relation to what the UK Government has done in relation to winter fuel payments. But I'll put that to one side for the purpose of this debate from the Chair. For myself, I think, Mr Balfour, this is where very well-intentioned political intent meets the harsh realities of budgetary constraints and the sobering fiscal position that I think the Scottish Government finds itself in, and there's a direct relation to Westminster fiscal positions and spending decisions in relation to that, which makes it incredibly difficult to land where Mr Balfour's landed in relation to the policy intent here, as well-intentioned as it is. And I think Ms Clark also made some reasonable points about if, and I say to Mr Stewart, if it was remotely possible to mitigate, despite the huge and severe financial pressures on this place, it needs to be considered in the round. And I don't think this is necessarily the way to do it, Mr Balfour, but I just want to put some of that on the record, and hopefully that's not strayed into the political arena, more about the practicalities of what we would all like to do. Cabinet Secretary, can I bring you in?
Thank you, Convener. Amendment 5 from Jeremy Balfour is focused on expanding eligibility to provide winter heating assistance via the winter heating payment to people on the higher rates of the pension, age, disability payment and attendance allowance. I would say from the outset that the way to protect people of pensionable age is for the UK Government to reverse the decision to means test winter fuel payment and to reinstate the payment for all pensioners. And can I pick Mr O'Kane up on one aspect which he said in particular? The Scottish Government does not agree to this. We are reluctantly being forced into a position, given the aforementioned £160 million cut from the government, from the UK Government. We do so, therefore, very much against our wishes on this issue. And it is indeed not too late for the UK Government to again reconsider their position on this, and we would all be in a better place for it. Members have mentioned... certainly.
Thank you very much. I just wonder, in terms of the context of a wider debate about the devolution of winter fuel payment and the evidence that was given by the Social Security Commission, the Poverty and Inequality Commission, around whether winter fuel payments should be means tested or not, and that said that should be explored. What is the Cabinet Secretary's view of that advice that came from her own commission?
Well, what I don't think the Commission actually meant was we were going to take that money away entirely. And I don't want to speak for them, but when I read the Commission report, if they were looking at means testing, I think I took from that they may wish us to use that money in another way to be able to provide support for other pensioners, not for the money to be whipped away by the UK Government and not available for anything at all. So there were was perhaps a point which the Commission raised around targeting, but I think that was for better use of the entire pot, not for most of the pot to be absolutely disappeared and not available to anyone. Now, Mr Balfour's amendments, as has already been mentioned, don't include disabled people who might receive other disability benefits. So even if his intent was to assist, he has missed some individuals out. And I'll come back onto that when we come to cost. Before winter heating assistance was introduced in 2023, the Scottish Government listened to our experienced panels and carried out a public consultation. And we decided to provide a stable £50 payment, which will be increased to £58.75 this coming winter, to replace the previous complex and weather dependent system. Making further changes to eligibility at this point, at this time, is not, in my view, the correct approach. Changes at this stage would present financial, legal and operational challenges, including but not limited to the negotiation of a new set of data sharing agreements with the DWP. Mr Balfour's proposal would also likely add, depending on a number of factors, around £6 million to the money spent on winter heating payment for 25-26. And of course, if others were to be included, given the fact I've already mentioned there are some other people on disability payments that this misses, that cost would of course increase. That's, of course, additional money not covered by the Scottish Block Grant, which would be have to be found from somewhere else. I have already committed, however, to continuing to review eligibility as we continue to deliver this important payment, and I believe that that continuing review should be informed by analysis and impact assessment, which would capture a wider group of people than the groups identified in Mr Balfour's amendments. For those reasons, Convener, the Government doesn't support Amendment 5, and I would invite Mr Balfour not to press it. There is indeed further discussions, I have no doubt, that we will have on the decision by the UK Government to take away the universality of winter fuel payment. We will again come back to what happens to support people that are in fuel poverty. But all of that, with the greatest respect, Mr Balfour, has to be done within the financial context we are under. And I would point to comments, for example, by Liz Smith, who is made in the Chamber, around the Scottish Fiscal Commission making it abundantly clear that much of the pressure that is faced by the country's finances is down to the Scottish Government's decision. For example, the extent of the gap between spending on devolved social security and the associated Block Grant adjustment. Now, the decision by the Scottish Government to invest more than the Block Grant adjustment is a political choice, but with the greatest respect to all members, the ability to come forward with amendments which place additional pressures on that Block Grant adjustment, not just in the benefit expenditure, but also in the cost of implementation, I would strongly suggest is something that needs to be discussed in the round, not on a stage two amendment. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. So we'll now turn to Jeremy Balfour to wind up and to press or withdraw Amendment 5.
Thank you, Deputy Convener. I think this has been a helpful debate. I think it is a debate that, you know, we will come back to again and again. I mean, if I can agree for once with the Cabinet Secretary, I do agree totally that the taking away of £160 million by the UK Government around this is deeply disappointing. I think to make your first big policy decision attacking some of the most vulnerable in society is not a great way for any government to start. I would point out to Mr Stewart that under the previous Conservative Government, the Block Grant has gone up every year ahead of inflation. So there is, yes, in real terms, Mr Stewart, and so there has more money to be spent. And again, it comes back to the point that we keep making. These are political choices that each party has to make in regard to how we spend the money. I do also think, and again, it goes back to previous points, so I won't labour it, Deputy Greener, is what is the role for the Social Security Scotland to do? Are we simply, as I think Mr Stewart seems to be saying, going to mirror image what happens at DWP level, Or are we going to do something that is best for the people that we represent here in Scotland? Happy to give way to Mr. Stewart.
Thanks to Mr. Balfour for giving way, convener. We don't mirror everything that is happening south of the border. Let's look, for example, at the investment in the Scottish child payment as being one of them. Let's look at the fact that benefits here have risen above inflation, which has not happened south of the border. But I think we also have to deal with the realities. As I said earlier, Mr. Balfour is a supporter of the union. That's up to him. But he also has to recognise that the actions of the UK Treasury have implications for spend here in Scotland. And when £160 million disappears, that does not leave much room for manoeuvre. And it certainly does not leave any room whatsoever for the expansion of benefits or for further mitigations. And I think Mr. Balfour has to deal with that reality.
Because it's quite an emotive point, but it was more of a speech than an intervention we got. But your points are now on the record. Mr. Balfour, if you could bring your remarks
I mean, I think just to respond briefly to what Mr. Stewart has said, Deputy Convener, I mean, I think, firstly, what he has talked about there is new benefits. He's not talked about existing benefits. And existing benefits at the moment, in regard to criteria and eligibility, can I just finish with one point? Eligibility do mirror. So, you know, the adult disability payment, the criteria and eligibility is exactly the same as that of PIP. There is no difference, Cabinet Secretary.
I appreciate it, Convener, you may be wishing to move things on, but for a point of clarity, the £1.1 billion in addition to the block grant adjustment that we invest, half a billion of that is on the Scottish child payment. Some of that, yes, is on additional payments, but there is also additional money that's going into adult disability payment because of the way we are running the system. So I'm afraid Mr. Balfour is not correct in saying that we have the same system, either in terms of culture or delivery, because quite frankly, Mr. Balfour, we wouldn't be spending £1.1 billion more if I was just doing a cut and paste from the DWP.
I think maybe the Cabinet Secretary intervened slightly too early there. I didn't talk about culture, I didn't talk about process, I talked about eligibility. And the eligibility rules, except for that of terminal illness, are identical from both systems. And I think that's important to get on the record.
You could talk about pressing or withdrawing your amendment.
Yeah, I can. Just two quick points, Convener, just to sum up. I am very happy to work together with all parties to move this forward. My concern is that if we keep talking about it for too long, nothing will happen. This is the opportunity for us as a Parliament to make a decision, and I hope we can revert to it at stage three. Again, Mr. Stewart, the Cabinet Secretary, and yourself, Mr. Dawes, talk about money, and absolutely, we get the money given to us by Westminster, but we then get to choose how we spend that money. You know, and if we maybe stopped getting our shipbuilding contracts so badly wrong, we would have more money to spend. If we didn't put people and start opening embassies in other parts of the world, we would get our money spent. So these are political choices that governments make. I think giving money to the most vulnerable society is what people would rather do rather than giving it to projects which the government simply cannot run.
I'm now giving you some latitude, Mr. Balfour, because you draw your marks to a close, please.
Well, can I have a point of order before I close?
Can you? Well, let me just check provisions for a point of order during... during the wing-up, there's no provisions for a point of order.
I will wait till after this. Okay. In that case, I press my amendment.
OK, thank you very much. That's helpful. So that being the case, the question is that Amendment 5 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
OK, we are not agreed. Those in support of Amendment 5, could you raise your hand, please? There being two in support. Those against Amendment 5... There are four votes against. Are there any abstentions? And there are two abstentions. So Amendment 5 falls. Now,
Just one moment, Mr. Balfour, if you'll bear with me. Is there a point of order provision just before suspending the meeting?
No, there's no point of order in committee.
Okay, so there are, just getting clarity, because I don't normally chair this committee, I'm deputy convener, there are no point of order procedures within committee. Mr. Balfour, we are about to suspend for a comfort break. If you want to discuss something informally with me, we can work out how we may handle what your point of order may have been when we get back into open session, okay? So can we suspend for a break, maybe to about 10:35 or so?
Welcome back, everyone. And our stage two considerations now continue, and we move to a new group on operating assistance for inflation. I call Amendment 6 in the name of Jeremy. You're having a bad day when you get things right and the clerks are still checking up on you.
My paper's been moved over, it's fine.
Thanks. So we are moving to a new group on operating assistance for inflation, and I am going to call Amendment 6 in the name of Jeremy Balfour and a group of its own. Jeremy Balfour to move and speak to Amendment 6.
Thank you again, Deputy Convener. Deputy Convener, when I lodged the number of amendments in my name, I have to confess I wasn't expecting great success in many of them. However, I was expecting cross-party support for this particular one, because the Scottish Government have been doing this since they've had the powers around benefits which are run here in Scotland. They have done it with inflation in the appropriate way. And the reason for bringing this amendment is to future-proof the bill for future years and future governments. I would think there would be mass outcry from this Parliament that if the UK government doesn't uprate with inflation benefits that they have control with every year, the disability community and many others in society would be outraged. The same should be here in Scotland, that the benefits that are run here in Scotland should go up with inflation. That would seem to me a fair thing to do. It seems inappropriate. And yes, I appreciate again, it comes with a cost. But surely that cost, if it's not raising by inflation, will be met by the disabled and the most vulnerable in our society. This seems to me, I would felt when I lodged it, more of a technical amendment, because it allows the Scottish Government to do something that they have done previously, which I hope they will do again in the next 14 to 15 months, but future-proofs it for future governments who may come from a different view. This seems to me reasonable, it seems to me proportionate, and I hope the committee will support it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Well spotted, Mr Balfour. Thank you. Kevin Short.
Thank you very much, Convener. And I don't think that the amendment itself is completely unreasonable. If this Parliament, if this place, had full control over finance, which we don't, all roads lead to Westminster, as Wes Streeting said during the course of the election campaign. And I'm quite sure that the Cabinet Secretary would wish to, under other circumstances, support this amendment. And, of course, the Cabinet Secretary is the one who has increased devolved benefits under her watch by more than inflation the circumstances of late. However, I think we have got to recognise that the UK Treasury still holds the purse strings. And there have been some surprises of late, and there may be more surprises to come, because the Prime Minister himself has said things are only going to get worse. So the realities are that the Cabinet Secretary and ourselves have no idea around about what the future block grant provision would look like. So we would be asking the Scottish Government to ensure that everything rose by inflation, not knowing if we are going to get the block grant required to be able to do that. That's a simple fact. Again, I would point out that as a supporter of the union, Mr Balfour is quite happy for the UK Treasury to hold those purse strings. I am not. But while we live in that world, this is putting the Cabinet Secretary, the Scottish Government, in an almost impossible position because they do not know what future financial provision there will be from the UK Treasury. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Mr Stewart. Any other contributions at this point, Mr O'Kane?
Thank you, Convener. I think just briefly to speak in support of the amendment in terms of, I think the principle is well established. I certainly think the principle of uprating UK benefits has been established and has been committed to in terms of the new government. I think that it is the expectation of organisations who support people, particularly those in the disabled community, and I think on the basis of the principle and intent, I think that is the right thing to do.
Any other contributions from members? Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Convener. As the committee is well aware, the Social Security Act of 2018 requires that benefits for disability, carers, employment injuries, funeral expenses, as well as the Scottish Child Payment, are uprated annually in line with inflation. However, as things stand, this duty does not extend to the Best Start grants, Best Start foods and winter heating payments. In our last budget, the Scottish Government uprated Social Security Scotland payments by 6.7%, including increasing our game-changing Scottish Child Payment to £26.70 a week. We know our payments are contributing to the Government's core mission of ending child poverty and helping to keep 100,000 children out of poverty this year. And we know that as prices soar in supermarkets, our annual uprating of Social Security payments protects the real value of pounds in people's pockets. The committee will be aware that the Scottish Government, since the first Scottish uprating exercise in 2019, has consistently chosen to also uprate payments subject only to discretionary uprating. Twice we have also responded quickly to changing conditions to increase benefits beyond inflation, as measured by the September CPI. And the points that Kevin Stewart has raised are quite correct. The decisions to uprate are decisions that then impact on the Scottish block grant adjustments. Now, there is a slight difference to this as compared to some of the other measures we have just discussed. As I've just mentioned, in previous years, we have uprated all benefits by inflation. In fact, as Mr Stewart says, we've gone further in some cases. But that financial cost to the Scottish Government is heightened by the fact that the UK Government is not legally obligated to uprate all benefits annually. And under devolution, the funding for uprating in Scotland through the block grant adjustment only fully covers those payments that have an equivalent in the rest of the UK that is also statutorily uprated. Not all benefits on the UK are uprated by inflation. So members will therefore appreciate that Scotland's pioneering approach to social security has only been possible with the bold decisions that we have taken within our budget. But against the backdrop of continued Westminster austerity under the new UK government, I am determined that this SNP government does whatever it can to provide further support to families and households. So I'm pleased to say that the Scottish Government intends to bring forward its own amendment on uprating at stage three. This will extend the existing statutory uprating duty, so it will apply to all of those payments provided by the Social Security Act of 2018. It means that this government is delivering more money for families in receipt of Best Start grants and Best Start foods. And, of course, Convener, it includes our winter heating benefits, a commitment I am particularly eager to confirm today, given that devastating decision by the UK government to cut winter fuel heating payments. But let me be very clear, this Parliament must not and should not be continuously forced to mitigate against the worst of the excesses of a Westminster government decision. This is the price that we pay for the Union. On the anniversary of the nation's independence referendum, this decision simply amplifies the urgency for full control of economic powers so we can build a future that invests in our communities with the decisions that we make here in Scotland. Now, Convener, I'm afraid there are technical issues in the drafting of Amendment 6 by Jeremy Balfour, so I cannot support it in its form. But with my commitment to bring forward a government amendment with the same intent, I would ask Mr Balfour not to press his amendment today.
Secretary, and we'll now move to Mr Balfour. Mr Balfour, could you wind up and decide whether to press or withdraw Amendment 6, please?
Thank you, Deputy Convener. Can I welcome the commitment by the Cabinet Secretary to bring forward a new amendment at stage three. I look forward to seeing that, and hopefully will be as she has outlined in her comments there. Just one quick remark, if I can, Deputy Convener. We rightly talk here, Mr Stewart talks, Cabinet Secretary talks, about a cost. And there is a cost. But we've also got to think of it as an investment in some of our most vulnerable people. And I would find it very hard to imagine any government not wanting to invest in the most vulnerable in our society by outrating assistance for inflation. I think that is something that is a moral duty on a government. And I absolutely acknowledge the Cabinet Secretary and her predecessors have done that. What I'm seeking to do, and I think what the Scottish Government are now seeking to do, is make sure that that goes on into the future. So I welcome the move by Scottish Government. I look forward to seeing the amendment, and on the basis of that, I won't be pressing my Amendment 6 this morning.
Thank you very much, Mr Balfour.
And because it's praised.
Oh, sorry, you're seeking to withdraw it, Mr Balfour?
It's seeking to virtual cake, Commissioner.
So, Mr Balfour seeking permission to withdraw the amendment. Are members content with that?
Agreed.
Okay. We now call Amendment 7 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 15. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not to move?
Not move, Convener.
The question is that Amendment 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
I've not moved, Convener, number 7.
Sorry, I've made the same thing. Bear with me. I see what I've done. My apologies, Mr Balfour. We will now move to a new group on discretionary housing payments, military compensation. I call Amendment 8, the name of Jeremy Balfour, in a group of its own. Jeremy Balfour to move and speak to Amendment 8.
Thank you, Deputy Convener. If the previous few groups have been fairly politicised, I think this particular amendment is less so. I'm grateful to Poppy Scotland, who have reached out and suggested this appropriate amendment. This is in regard to discretionary housing payment and compensation and how that affects housing payment. I'm looking forward to hearing what the Cabinet Secretary is going to say on that. I think there is a principle here that if you're involved in a civil claim and get civil amounts of money, then that is not used in regard to discretionary housing payment decisions. However, if you have a military compensation, that is included. That just seems to me unfair on those who have served our country, and I look forward to seeing how the Cabinet Secretary would like to deal with this appropriate amendment. I will leave it there, but I will move it officially.
Thank you, Mr Balfour. Do any other members wish to speak at this point? I move to the Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Convener. The Scottish Government doesn't support Amendment 8, which seeks to make local authorities disregard military compensation as income when deciding whether to provide a discretionary housing payment. But that's not because we think that military compensation should be counted as income in these circumstances. But there are potential issues with Mr Balfour's amendment, and we would suggest in any case that we do not consider the face of the bill an appropriate place for this policy. While the Government is keen to encourage consistency across different parts of the country, it's important to retain a level of discretion that allows for applications to be assessed on a case-by-case basis. Discretion is baked into that design. But that said, Convener, my officials will soon be undertaking a review, and given Mr Balfour's concerns about timeframes in other groupings, I would reassure him it is due for next month, so not too long to wait, Mr Balfour. The officials will be undertaking a review of the statutory discretionary housing payment guidance, which we consider as a more appropriate place for this policy than primary legislation. And we have concerns that the amendment would leave out other recipients of other different forms of compensation, which we may, when we undertake the review, also wish to include in addition to military compensation. We are more than happy to work broadly with all stakeholders, including, of course, Poppy Scotland and Mr Balfour directly, to ensure that the intent behind his amendment is integral to the work that's undertaken as that part of the review. So I would recommend that the committee doesn't support this amendment if Mr Balfour presses, not because it's wrong in principle, but because it doesn't belong in primary legislation, and because we want to ensure that any approach does not leave out other people who may be awarded other types of compensation. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Mr Balfour, to wind up and to press or withdraw Amendment 8.
Yeah, briefly, Deputy Convener, I welcome the comments made by the Cabinet Secretary on this. I look forward to that consultation being taken place. I'm grateful that she will include all stakeholders in regard to that. I do absolutely acknowledge that my amendment does leave out other potential groups who might be affected by this. But I think it was important to have a debate here so that Poppy Scotland and other organisations are assured that this will happen in a timely manner, and I look forward to the new guidance reflecting where we are today and hopefully protecting those who have served our country but also others who have had compensation given to them. And on that basis, I seek to withdraw my amendment.
Are members content that Mr Balfour can withdraw Amendment 8?
Agreed.
Okay. I call Amendment 105 in the name of Paul O'Kane, already debated with Amendment 24. Paul O'Kane, to move or not to move?
On the basis of our debate, not moved.
The question is that Section 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? I call Amendment 28 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 24. Cabinet Secretary, formally move. The question is that Amendment 28 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes. Yes.
Committee is agreed. The question is that Section 4 to 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We now move to a new grouping. New determination of entitlement after error. And I call Amendment 106 in the name of Jeremy Balfour. Group with amendments as shown in the groupings. Jeremy Balfour to Amendment 106 to speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. I move Amendment 106 in my name. This is a fairly technical amendment, and I'm grateful to CPAC and Citizens Advice Scotland who have had discussions around this. Currently, Social Security Scotland does not have the power to make a new determination while waiting for an appeal to be heard. And if I give an example of this, a client is currently waiting Scottish Child Payment appeal. The Social Security Scotland appeals officer conceded that the decision is incorrect and should have been changed at the redetermination. Social Security Scotland currently does not have the power to make that new determination and stop the appeal. Instead, it can only invite the tribunal to award Scottish Child Payment. This causes unnecessary stress for an appeal for the individual and an unnecessary administration for Social Security Scotland and the tribunal service. This, Deputy Convener, actually happens more frequently than perhaps we would expect. As I said with my declarations of interest, when I sat on tribunals, on a fairly frequent basis, the then representative of DWP would come along. He or she would say, I've looked at the papers afresh and disagree with the original decision and ask the tribunal to make a decision as the claimant had wanted in the first place. That obviously wastes time, energy, money, and also in regard to the stress, most importantly, of the claimant. And Section 7 here introduces a duty for Social Security Scotland to make a new determination, but only under three categories. The first tier tribunal has not yet decided the appeal. It has been identified that the original determination is less generous than it should have been due to an error, and the individual has consented to a new determination being made. Now, I welcome those provisions as it allows individuals to access for full entitlement without having to wait for an appeal and will reduce unnecessary stress and administration. However, I think it would benefit from some modification, and my amendment seeks to do this. Section 49A, brackets 1B, specifies that there has been an error in the original determination. The requirement for an error to be identified requires the decision maker to look for something that is legally wrong with the previous determination, whereas it could simply be a different view of the same facts. There are already examples of this in case law. For example, NB v Social Security Scotland, the same points were awarded at the determination and redetermination stage. These were insufficient to award ADP. Even though they did not appear to have any new evidence available to Social Security Scotland, its written submission to the tribunal departed from the previous two decisions recommending that additional points be awarded, sufficient for ADP to be awarded at the enhanced rate. The submission did not identify an error in law with the previous decision, but simply a different interpretation of the evidence presented. Now, the policy intent is to allow a decision maker to make a more favourable determination. The requirement to identify an error, I would suggest, inserts an unnecessary and additional test that could be applied in quite a restrictive way, despite the intention that the definition of error is quite broad. So I would suggest that to remove that would be a helpful way forward. And so on that basis, I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Mr. Balfour. Any member wish to speak on this amendment? In which case, I'll call the Cabinet Secretary.
Convener, the Scottish Government supports amendments 109, 110 and 111 from Jeremy Balfour. We consider that the definition of error in section 49A is very broad and that the bill as drafted will allow a new determination to be made and an appeal stopped in a wide range of scenarios, including where a decision maker reaches a different conclusion on the same facts. However, I am content that amendments 109, 110 and 111 as drafted meet the policy intention that a decision maker should be able to make a more favourable determination for the client during an appeal. And on that basis, the Scottish Government is happy to support these amendments. We may bring forward amendments at stage 3 to make some small technical changes to these provisions, but I can assure Mr Balfour they would not alter the policy. Convener, turning to amendment number 112, the Scottish Government does not support this amendment. Amendment 112 seeks to remove the definition of error in the bill as far as it relates to allowing Social Security Scotland to make a new determination and an appeal to stop as a result. Whilst we are supportive of this and would support Mr Balfour's other amendments which seek to remove the need for error in this process, this amendment also seeks to remove the need for any new determination to be advantageous for the client. We believe it is an important aspect of this process that a client only be offered an advantageous award in order to stop an appeal. This has been the intention behind this proposal since it was first introduced in the bill and remains an important aspect of the offer that would be made to a client. Removing this may result in Social Security Scotland contacting a client to offer them a lower award than that which they are challenging in the first place. The Government does not therefore support Amendment 112, and I ask Jeremy Balfour not to press it. However, if Amendments 109, 110 and 111 are accepted, at Stage 3 we will remove the unnecessary definition of error that the Amendment 112 identifies. Convener, the Scottish Government also cannot support Amendments 106, 107 and 108, or Amendments 113, 114 and 115 from Jeremy Balfour. These amendments seek to remove the requirement for a client to request a redetermination of the determination which stopped the appeal. Our focus is on getting the decisions right first time. However, if a client disagrees with the determination which stopped the appeal, a right of redetermination provides the opportunity to correct any mistakes at an early stage through an independent rerun. Giving people redetermination and appeal rights in this scenario gives people the same range of challenge rights that are given to people challenging all other determinations made under the 2018 Act. Some clients may find the tribunal process intimidating and stressful and may prefer the opportunity to have Social Security Scotland look at their case again rather than appealing to the tribunal. In addition, not everyone who has lodged an appeal will have had a previous redetermination outcome. Some people may have appealed because their redetermination was not concluded by Social Security Scotland within the timescale set out in the regulations. It should also be noted that even if the Government agreed in principle with these amendments, they would not, as currently drafted, achieve the intended purpose. Some references to redeterminations have not been removed and therefore the legislation would not work properly. Convener, for these reasons, I would urge the committee to support Mr Balfour's amendments 109, 110 and 111, but not amendments 106, 107, 108, 112, 113, 114 and 115. And I ask Jeremy Balfour not to press those latter amendments. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Mr Balfour, to press a withdrawal amendment 106.
Thank you, Deputy Convener. To keep this fairly brief, I welcome the Government's move on 110, 111 and 112 and thank the Cabinet Secretary for that. I look forward in regard to her redrafting of Amendment 112 at Stage 3 and certainly happy to work with her in regard to that. I do accept her points in regard to 106, 107, 108, 113, 14 and 15. I would like to reflect on that. I also acknowledge that the drafting isn't as complete as it should be. That is my fault. So I would withdraw 106 and seek to see what happens at Stage 3. So not move 106.
So it has been moved, but you're seeking to withdraw. So Mr Balfour seeks to withdraw Amendment 106. Does any member object? Okay, no not member objecting. Amendment 106 is therefore withdrawn. I call Amendment 107 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 106. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 108 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 106. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendments 109, 110 and 111 all in the name of Jeremy Balfour.
Can we not do that? Because I don't want to move 109, but I would want to move the others.
Right. So I call Amendment 109.
My apologies, Convener. Sorry, my apologies, Convener. I can't read my own notes. Again, bow to your superior knowledge.
I'm glad I was so persuasive from the chair there, Mr Balfour. So I'll read that again, just for certainty and for the official report. I call Amendments 109, 110 and 111, all in the name of Jeremy Balfour and all previously debated. I invite Jeremy Balfour to move Amendments 109 to 111 on block.
Move, Convener.
Does any member object to a single question being put to Amendments 109, 110 and 111? Okay. With no member objecting, the question is that Amendments 109, 110 and 111 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. I call Amendment 112 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 106. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not to move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 113 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 106. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not move?
If it's helpful, 113, 114 and 115, I won't be moving any three of them if that helps. But I won't move 113.
I have a discreet whisper in my ear saying, let's just run through the process anyway.
But sure.
Thanks for noting that. So, not moved. And just for clarity, that was 113. Okay. I call Amendment 114 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 106. To move or not to move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 115 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 106. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not to move?
Not move.
The question is that Section 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. We move to a new section, Appeal to First Tier Tribunal against Process Decisions. And I call Amendments 116 in the name, Amendment singular in the name of 116, in the name of Jeremy Balfour, group with amendments as shown in the group. Jeremy Balfour, to move Amendment 116 to speak to all others within the group.
Thank you, Deputy Convener. I move 116 in my name. Again, these are technical but I think important amendments in regard to actually how cases are determined. as drafted in section 61A, brackets 2 and brackets 4 of the bill, mean that if the first tier tribunal decides that further information is required before an application or redetermination request can be deemed to have been made correctly, Social Security Scotland must firstly try to obtain that information, and secondly, if the information is not obtained, make a decision rejecting the application or redetermination request and notify the individual of their right to lodge a process appeal to the first-tier tribunal again. This amendment would mean that if a first-tier tribunal decides that further information is required before the application or redemption request can be deemed to have been made correctly, Social Security may seek that information, and whether or not the information obtained must make a decision on entitlement based on information that they do have. If I can give an example, an individual claimed adult disability payment and submitting parts 1 and 2 of a form, but Social Security Scotland could not verify the ID. The first-tier tribunal decided more information was required before his ID could be verified. The individual was unable to provide the information required, so Social Security Scotland rejected his claim again and advised him of his right to make a process appeal again. This amendment would introduce a right of appeal to the Upper Tribunal for Scotland in process appeals, which would allow the development of case law in this area. Case law develops precedents about how legislation should be interpreted and applied. Developing case law on process appeals could contribute to the continuous improvement of the Social Security system, one of the principles set out in the 2018 Act. Section 8 of the bill provides further clarity for the first-tier tribunal about how to respond to process appeals, which suggests the current legislation is not clear. Further clarity may be required, which would not become evident until more press appeals are requested. The Upper Tribunal could consider issues of ambiguity and develop legally binding case law, preventing the need for further amendment to the primary legislation before this can be addressed. And for that reason, I move Amendment 116 in my name.
Thank you, Mr. Balfour. Does any other member wish to contribute? There being no other member, can I call the Cabinet Secretary?
Convener, the Scottish Government cannot support Amendments 118 to 125 from Jeremy Balfour. These amendments relate to process appeals at the first-tier tribunal. This is where clients can challenge process decisions, for example, if Social Security Scotland has rejected an application or redetermination request as invalid if it was not submitted in the correct form or was incomplete. The first-tier tribunal can decide whether or not the process decision made by Social Security Scotland was right. In addition, it can decide that more information is needed to make the application or redetermination request valid, and it can instruct Social Security Scotland to seek this information from the client. Process appeals only look at process decisions. They do not cover the level of an award or overall entitlement, which are covered as part of redeterminations and appeals. Amendments 118 to 125 would mean that following a process appeal, Social Security Scotland would have to make a determination of entitlement in scenarios where the tribunal has said that more information is needed, regardless of whether this additional information is provided by the client. This is unfair, as clients who have made a process appeal would be treated differently than other clients who have also submitted an invalid application but who did not seek a process appeal. It could also disadvantage anyone who received a decision from the tribunal during a process appeal that Social Security Scotland was correct to reject their application or redetermine request. In practical terms, if Scottish ministers do not have the required information as set out in the 2018 Act, they are not in a position to make a determination of entitlement. An example of this might be if a client does not submit Part 2 of an application for a disability benefit because Part 2 of the application contains information about a client's needs and eligibility for that disability benefit. The Government does not, therefore, support Amendments 118 to 125, and I would ask Mr Balfour not to press. Turning to Amendments 116 and 117, the Scottish Government does not support these amendments, which would allow people to appeal a decision of the first-tier tribunal in the upper tribunal. We do not consider these amendments necessary. Most of process appeals are based on facts of the appeal, for example, whether a client has completed a benefit application correctly or submitted a redetermination request on time. while upper tribunal appeals can only be brought on a point of law. The number of process appeals received to date is very small, and my understanding is that if required and where appropriate, the first tier tribunal may seek guidance from the upper tribunal in circumstances where the first tier tribunal has to consider whether or not the appellant had a good reason for requesting a redetermination late. As such, the Government does not support Amendments 116 and 117, and I would ask Mr Balfour not to press.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Mr Balfour, to wind up, to press or withdraw Amendment 116.
Thank you, Deputy Convener. I with due respect to the Cabinet Secretary, disagree with her reasoning around this. I do accept, in regard to guidance from the first tier, can see guidance in regard to that. However, that guidance is not binding, and I think what would be really helpful as we go forward here in Scotland is to build up a case law around this which would allow first tier tribunals certainty in regard to making decisions. I also, in regard to 118 through to 125, also just come to a different view in regard to that of the Cabinet Secretary, and so I will be pressing 116.
Okay, that being the case, the question is that Amendment 116 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
Okay, the committee is not agreed, so we'll move to a vote. All those in favour of Amendment 116, could you raise your hand, please? That being two members. All those against? That being six members. And Amendment 116 falls. I call Amendment 117 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 116. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not move?
Not move, Convener.
Thank you. I call Amendment 118 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with 116, to move or not move?
Moved.
That being the case, the question is that Amendment 118 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. All those in favour of Amendment 118, could you raise your hands, please? That being two members. All those against? That being four members. Are there any abstentions? There are two abstentions. So Amendment 118 is not agreed to. I call Amendment 119 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 116. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not move?
Not move. Again, if it is helpful to the convener, the 119 through to 125, I won't be moving any of those if you want to take them on block.
Can't do it. Can't take it. Not move on block.
Okay. In terms of process, that's not possible, I'm afraid, Mr Balfour, but I do appreciate you trying to be helpful. So, just to confirm, 119 is not moved, is that correct? Okay. I call Amendment 120 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 116, to move or not move?
Not move.
Not moved. I call Amendment 121 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 116, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 122 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 116. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not to move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 123 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 116. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not to move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 124 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 116. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not to move?
Not move.
And I call Amendment 125, also, funnily enough, in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 116. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not to move?
Not move, Convener.
Thank you, Mr Balfour. The question is that Section 8 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. I call Amendment 29 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 25. Cabinet Secretary, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 29 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay. We are not all agreed. There will be a division. All those in favour of Amendment 29, could you raise your hands, please?
that being 6 members. All those against the amendment, that being 2 members, and there are no abstentions. So Amendment 29 is agreed to. I call Amendment 30 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 25. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 30 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Did you check where we are? We just jump to this one.
You've just read the questions that we've agreed to. Is that where we've got to?
Yes, I'm just going straight to here.
So
section 10.
31.
Yeah, so I'm calling Amendment 31.
Yes.
Yeah. Just checking we know where we are within the process. I'm going to call Amendment 31 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 25. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 31 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. I call Amendment 32 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 25. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 32 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. I call Amendment 33 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 25. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 33 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? That is agreed to. I call Amendment 34 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 25. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 34 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That is agreed. The question is that Section 12 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendments 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48 and 49 and Amendment 50 also, all in the name of the Cabinet Secretary and all previously debated. I would invite the Cabinet Secretary to move amendments 35 through to 50 on block.
Moved on block, convener.
Now, I'm very hopeful here that no member will object to a single question being put on all these amendments 35 through to 50. Does any member object? Thank you. So the question is that amendments 35 through to 50 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. Section 13?
Yes.
Yeah. The question is that section 13 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 51 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 25. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 51 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
So we're moving to a fresh group, but I would intend, I think, ending the first stage consideration of stage two there. So can I thank the Cabinet Secretary and her team for joining us this morning. And that also concludes our public business for today. Should I put on record when the next stage two will be taken? So that will be taken on Thursday the 26th of September, return to for the conclusion of stage two. But that does include our public business for today. And we'll now move into private session to consider the remaining items on the agenda. Thank you, everybody.